Why is it so difficult to get to Pluto? Pluto is the furthest celestial body a spacecraft has reached. This dwarf planet is more than 6 billion kilometers from Earth, and the only spacecraft that has managed to observe it directly was New Horizons on July 14, 2015. However, this ship did not enter orbit around Pluto. It observed it once and continued on its way to the far reaches of the solar system. But why spend so many resources just for a straightforward approach to Pluto? Let's find out. The furthest of all. For many years, Pluto was considered the ninth planet in the solar system and the farthest of all. Located at the far reaches of the realm of the sun, it seemed that it would take centuries for humanity to reach this small world. However, the first opportunity to visit Pluto came much earlier than most scientists imagined. It was the year 1964 when the scientist at the JPL laboratory of NASA called Gary Flandro realized that between 1976 and 1978, there would be a gap of approach between the gaseous planets. So if a space exploration probe was launched on those dates, it could visit most of the outer planets using a series of successive gravitational assists, taking advantage of the unusual planetary alignment that occurs almost every two centuries. Shortly after, NASA launched an ambitious project called Grand Tour, which would be starring two twin TOPS probes, although in principle, they should be four. One of the probes would be launched in 1976 or 1977 to explore Jupiter, Saturn, and Pluto, while the second would visit Jupiter, Uranus, and Neptune. According to NASA's plans, the encounter with Pluto would occur in 1985 or 1986. After analyzing the ambitious Grand Tour project, NASA concluded that its cost would be too high, so the Grand Tour project and the TOPS probes were canceled. Shortly after, NASA would launch a new, more modest and less expensive project, and from there would arise the famous Voyager exploration probes. Voyagers were initially scheduled to follow the same trajectories as the Grand Tour project, and NASA retained the option of sending Voyager 1 to Pluto after it visited Saturn. If the mission had been approved, Voyager 1 would have flown by the Pluto system in the spring of 1986. Instead, NASA preferred to send the probe closer to Titan, Saturn's largest moon, rather than Pluto. So once again, any visit to Pluto was canceled. Why were missions to Pluto canceled again and again? The reason is simple. Pluto is too far away. A challenge for the technology of the time. The Voyager probes did not have solar panels since they were intended to explore distant planets. In those regions, the solar radiation was very low, and a solar panel could not supply enough energy. Instead, the probes had nuclear batteries that produced electrical energy from the thermal radiation emitted by a radioactive compound. NASA concluded that due to natural wear and tear, this source of radioactive energy could eventually be exhausted long before reaching Pluto. So instead of losing the spacecraft, it was decided to take the opportunity to visit Titan. No one expected that after visiting Titan, Voyager's power source would still work. It was simply a stroke of luck. After these missions, NASA declared that Pluto is a lonely, small, and distant world. So the ships that visited in the future necessarily had to be complex and very expensive. Many scientists thought it was better to spend that money on studying the giant planets and their dozens of satellites, so the ninth planet would have to wait. During the 80s, no serious proposal to explore Pluto emerged, although there were undoubtedly exciting projects. The most curious of these was the Interstellar Precursor Mission, IPM, study of the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, JPL. The IPM mission aimed to send a massive probe to the heliopause, the solar system's edge where the solar wind gives way to the interstellar medium in a relatively short time. The probe would have a mass of about 90 tons. Yes, you heard correctly, 90 tons. That is the heaviest exploration probe in history and therefore should be assembled into Earth orbit by more than 5 space shuttle missions. This spacecraft would be equipped with a nuclear reactor and use an electric propulsion system, NEP, with ion engines. And what relationship did IPM have with Pluto? Well, this had to carry a probe to study the ninth planet that would separate when passing through its vicinity. The orbiter would be similar to the Galileo probe for studying Jupiter. It would use a propulsive stage, that is, a rocket to reduce its high speed and place itself in orbit around Pluto, which would hopefully take place during the first decade of the 21st century. As you may be imagining, this never saw the light, since once again the cost of such a project would be exorbitantly high. Spark the spark of curiosity. In 1989, Voyager 2 had its encounter with Neptune. This event revived interest in a mission to Pluto, since this was the only planet left to explore. In addition, Triton, Neptune's largest moon, had turned out to be a complex world with an atmosphere, polar ice caps, and nitrogen geysers. Observations from Earth indicated that Triton and Pluto shared a common origin in the Kuiper Belt, and therefore must be very similar, especially since it was discovered in 1988 that Pluto was also shrouded in a tenuous atmosphere. In addition, in 1978, Pluto's first moon, Charon, was discovered, so a probe could now explore two worlds for the price of one. A mission to Pluto once again climbed the scientific community's priorities. One of the first proposals was the Pluto 350 mission. The name referred to the weight of the spacecraft, which should not exceed 350 kilograms, including the radioisotope generator, RTG, to produce energy. Pluto 350 was born 2 months after Voyager 2's encounter with Neptune. It was to include only four instruments: a camera, an ultraviolet spectrometer for the study of the atmosphere, a radio experiment to observe the atmosphere mainly, and an instrument for plasma analysis. Among the architects of the mission was a planetary scientist named Alan Stern, who would be a key piece in the history of Pluto's exploration. Scientists feared that the dwarf planet's atmosphere would freeze as the planet moved away from the equinox that had occurred in 1987, so the launch should take place as soon as possible. Like the rest of the spacecraft proposals to Pluto, the Pluto 350 mission was to fly by Jupiter to perform a gravitational assistance maneuver and thus reduce the flight time by 2 or 3 years, depending on the launch window. To place the ship on a direct trajectory to the gas giant, the mission had to be launched by a large rocket, a Titan III or a Titan IV, which was the most potent American launcher at the time. However, this requirement increased the cost of the mission. Paradoxically, the Pluto 350 mission suffered rejection from NASA for being too simple. This is because many scientists and engineers claim that launching a 350-kilogram probe into the outer solar system was a recklessness that had no chance of success, considering that previously the Voyagers had a mass at launch of about 800 kilograms. In other words, NASA preferred a more complex and expensive mission, but with a guarantee of success, than a simple mission, but with the possibility of failure. Missions that never saw the light of day. In an era of meager budgets, NASA focused on simple flyby missions. In 1992, JPL's Robert Stale went further and announced the Pluto Fast Flyby, PFF mission. A tiny mission compared to anything that had been done until then. If Pluto 350 were once a small probe, PFF would be tiny since its mass would be less than 150 kilograms. A few years before, few believed such a probe could be built. But with the constant cuts to NASA's budget, these new low-cost missions became almost the only option. Years later, NASA rejected the Pluto Fast Flyby mission proposal and replaced it with a new mission called Pluto Express. Since David Jewett and Jane Liu discovered the first body in the Kuiper Belt in 1992, it was becoming increasingly apparent that Pluto was not a planet like the rest, but a member of this new family of trans-Neptunian objects. For this reason, the mission would be baptized as Pluto Kuiper Express, PKE. At 175 kilograms, PKE would be slightly larger than Pluto Fast Flyby at 140 kilograms and carry 9 kilograms of scientific instruments, although its design was similar. Ultimately, both Pluto Fast Flyby and Pluto Kuiper Express were canceled due to budget cuts, but a mission to Pluto remained a scientific priority, as the launch window from 2001 to 2006 was inexorably approaching, and then there would be no other chance. So, in desperation, in 2000, NASA created a public contest to choose a mission to Pluto. This strategy had worked very well on low-cost missions called Discovery, but never before had such an expensive probe been attempted. Since the mission to Pluto required a more expensive mission than a Discovery-type mission, but cheaper than a flagship mission, NASA decided in 2002 to create the New Frontiers category for this type of probe. This is how, on February 5, 2001, winning proposal was the New Horizons. At first, it would carry four scientific instruments. These would be Percy, which included the ALICE ultraviolet spectrometer, the MVIC color camera, the LISA infrared spectrometer, REX, a radio experiment, LORI, a black and white telescopic camera, PATH, for the study of particles. To reduce the mass and cost of the probe, the corners of the triangular structure were trimmed and the diameter of the antenna had to be reduced from 3 to 2.1 meters. The final mass of the vehicle reached 478 kilograms. The total cost of the mission would be $646 million in 2014. The probe was launched from Cape Canaveral on January 19, 2006. New Horizons approached Jupiter between February and March of 2007 to take advantage of the planet's gravitational assistance, and thus acquire a speed difference of about 4,023 meters per second, or 14,482 kilometers per hour. In July of 2013, the probe sent back the first images in which Pluto and its largest satellite, Charon, can be distinguished as separate bodies. As New Horizons approached Pluto, the images sent back gained resolution. Until the day everyone expected on July 14, 2015, the New Horizons probe passed 12,500 kilometers from Pluto's surface at a relative speed of 49,600 kilometers per hour, taking the sharpest images it had ever seen of what was once the ninth planet in the solar system. In addition to photographing Pluto, the probe also sent tons of information that has served to discover all the mysteries of this celestial body. Thanks to this, today we know that Pluto is a vast ball covered with ice with recent geological activity, and that it could contain water. After the Pluto flyby, the New Horizons probe continued its journey to the solar system's far reaches. To date, no other mission has managed to reach this distant world. Do you think we will ever revisit Pluto? Let us know your opinion in the comments.